This morning, our first speaker will be Dr. Pamela Snow.
I didn't come to class to be called on.
Whoever does.
I came to class fed.
I guess that's greedy, you know. But nevertheless, I am glad, thankful, grateful to Yahweh that He allowed me to have the strength to make it to class today. Now, I would like to speak about the everpresence of Yahweh, because we have to recognize that step first and announce His presence if we want to understand anything about Him. Now, we have so many things that is being preached in this school today. And that is no surprise, because there were so many things that was preached in the school when even the founder himself, who had this divine panoramic vision and divine panoramic revelation, there was things that was taught that was wrong. So it is of no surprise to me, and I want to encourage you all to not allow it to be a surprise to you. But as the scripture said, there were 7 messengers and there's 7 assemblies. So see, we aren't left alone. We will be taught the truth. But you've got to pay attention. And you've got to do your homework. I can sit up and I can talk to you about Abraham, who, when you look in our ages and dispensations, and I'm going to try not to be up here long. In our ages and dispensations, this was the first, this is the second age. This is the antediluvian dispensation. Okay? Now, we had the creative age. You see the dots? That means these were happening at the same time. Why? Because it was in the spirit. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, you can't understand anything in this angelic creation if you don't understand this creative or this physical creation. Now, when Adam, the Garden of Eden, took away the creative age, if I can put it, and it brought in your diluvian age or your ages of dispensations. That's why you see dispensation started here, not here. It was started here. Okay? Now, here we have Adam, okay? And we say in Adam, all died. But then in the Messiah, all was resurrected. We had the first, and we had the last. But now what about all this in between? Now I'm here to share with you that all this that was in between was pointing up to that which was instituted and that which is fulfilled. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's one big story. There's no many stories. It's one story. It says, "Hear, O Israel, for Yahweh, our Elohim, is Yahweh a unity. There is no one beside Him." is one. Now that's what makes the difference between this school and the churches. Because they believe in a Trinity. They believe in Lord, God, and Jesus Christ. And these are three. Do you understand what I'm saying? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But we have Yahweh, Father, Elohim, Word or Son, Yahshua, the Holy Spirit. But these three are one. Now the reason why this was broken down, it says, my sheep hear my voice and will not follow a stranger. Now these are broken down this way to give a starting point for us in our physical, concrete, limited mind to be able to understand something about our Heavenly Father. Okay? Now, when it was broken down, it's only because it was only Dr. Kinley came out of the Church of God. So then he was speaking to the people that was in the church. But if you look at it, it took him, what was it, 30 or 40 years before he brought out the name? I can't recall. But it took him a while before he brought out the name. But he said, Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua are one. He didn't say that they were three. And he backed it up with Ayah, or Ayah, Asher, Ayah. I will be what I will to be. So in other words, everything that you see, everything that is manifested, everything that you even imagine is somewhat of another expression of Yahweh. Even the satanic spirit, because he created him. But he created him not as a worthy adversary to you, a worthy adversary to you, but to him. Now he expressed it that way, but in all reality, he is a worthy adversary to you also. Because why? Where does Yahweh live? He lives in you.
That's right.
So that Lucifer, that Satan, the devil, and his dragon live in you, just like Yahweh lives in you. You see what I'm saying? But he broke himself down because we would not understand pure spirit. Your moderator got up and he spoke. Now that's what you call a canned speech. But I'm telling you, that will take you from now to eternity to understand. But it's just to get your attention. But he tells you that Yahweh is spirit, symbolized within the cloud. Why within the cloud? Because he is not a cloud. He is symbolized as a cloud. Okay? Why would you say he's not a cloud when he's everything? Because we don't want you to limit him as a cloud.
That's right. That's
not true. Do you understand what I'm saying? He is spirit. Okay? So then we have Yahweh. Now we have inside this cloud, we have the migratory trip. Okay? Not only do we have the migratory trip, we also have everything that happened through the ages and dispensation right down here on this bottom plate. You see what I'm saying? Everything that happened in the dispensation right here in the holy place. And everything that happened in the dispensation right here in the most holy place. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now that's the same thing that happens in this chart, which we call the elementary chart. But it was pinned as the chart on the pattern or plan of salvation. So everything that you have in your scriptures is in this chart.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Then we have our Old Testament and New Testament chart, okay? We have our carnal ordinances, okay? Which the Jews did back here under the law. Then you have Yahshua the Messiah, who was worthy to come in and to fulfill that which was instituted. Now, how could he fulfill that which was instituted unless he already knew what was instituted? So he fulfilled those things that were written and those things that are unwritten. Now, there is a type to show that that is correct, because everything that Dr. Kimley taught, I'm telling you, I was an eyewitness to those things. But everything that he taught is not, just like we say it's not in the scriptures, well, it is not in the transcripts. Every transcript of every lecture that Dr. Kimley gave was not all of his lectures. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, so now let's move on. I brought some stuff, and I'm going to go through real quick, and I want to sit down. Now, we have people, which you need to know, very, very important. We have this one here, 40 days, blood and water, okay? Well, right on the back of this pamphlet, you have the steps of the tabernacle. You have the steps of the tabernacle. Now, you can say, oh, well, I'm senior. Well, I'm senior. That's why I said that. I'm of the senior age. Okay? So you forget. This eradicates my excuse. But you know what? I'm only showing you this as a type. This is written here. The Spirit of Yahweh is here. So how can I forget? Dr. Kimley even said himself, now I'm at the age where people will say I'm senile. He said, but I tell you what, I can't forget this. He said, I cannot forget this. Okay? But for those of us that do not understand, are babes and still need milk, you have a pamphlet. And it gives you the steps. If you don't have it, ask for it. Somebody can get it for you. That's how we are. This is a school and not a church. There is not a question that you can ask that can't be answered. Now, I may not be able to answer it, but I certainly can show you somebody who can. Do you see what I'm saying? Now, the difference between us and the churches is because they'll say you're meddling in God's business. Now, that's why I'm talking about I want to show the ever-presence of Yahweh. Because there is a difference between us and the school. We are a research school. And I'm going to say it again, because people have not understood it. We have in our moderation, sure, we have in our moderation that we are not affiliated with any of the churches. But we're not religion. Why? Because we research religion. We are not scientific. Why? Because we research scientific. And if you put us in a box, then you are dealing away with the ever-presence of Yahweh himself. If you put us in a box like they have. If you resemble anything that they are doing, then you have forgotten the ever-presence and the will of Yahweh. And what he came in to do was to fulfill that which he instituted, so that we may come to some understanding of him, that there is a purpose and there is a plan. Now, I marked this down. I don't know if we have a scripture reader, but would somebody give me Isaiah 14:14, Leviticus 16:2? Then I want to just share a little bit of something that, while you're getting that, I'm going to go ahead and share. If I can find it.
You want Isaiah 14:14?
Yes, please. But let me share this here real quick. It's just something that I wanted to show, because we have evolution, and people want to say that we are from apes or monkeys. So I just want to share this.
We are apes.
Yeah, well, that's what they're saying. But we are not. Okay. Is there a difference? Yes. Now, see, I researched this. So if I research this, then this information is there. It's out there. Mm-hmm. All you got to do is research it too. Mm-hmm. Okay? But see, sometimes we have a habit. We think when we come to class that we're doing Yahweh a service. But don't you know? Just your existence is doing Yahweh a service. And class is 24/7 with me. I can't say about you. I hope it's 24/7 with you, but I know it is with me. I have enough tapes to start a library. I have enough transcripts to further extend that library. And guess what? I refer to them every time I'm not able to make it to class. I am looking at those things, because I want to see the progression. Just like you had the talents. He says, I gave you 7, I gave you 5, and I gave you 1. Well, this one here multiplied it, the other one multiplied it, and the other one said, oh, wait a minute, now I know you're a hard tax master. Why did he say that? Because he's looking back here at the hard taskmaster that he was here. These people died. Did you understand? If they didn't do. So he says, I know he was a hard taskmaster.
Well, it kept coming.
So I kept it. I kept that. So here it is. And he said, depart from me. Why, you never knew me. And he gave his talent to somebody else. Okay? So then we are about growth here. Not growth in changing the doctrine, but in growth in understanding the doctrine. Now, what would you do if you were back here? They didn't put your mindset. They didn't have TV. They didn't have the internet. They didn't have the cell phone. Do you see what I'm saying? They didn't have those things. So when you put yourself back there, when you read that scripture, it will help you to understand if you get rid of your inventions. That's just the key. Get rid of your inventions. And when you get rid of your inventions, you will be able to somewhat understand what these people were teaching us. They were teaching us. They weren't wrong. They were doing what they were instructed to do, to teach us. And if you do any research, anybody that's not an eyewitness, they do have a transcript where Dr. Kennedy himself said that this here was a schoolmaster. I'm hitting that chart with my hand. Excuse me. That this here was a schoolmaster. It was to teach us. Okay? So then you can't kick against the prick, if I can put it that way. You can't kick against them and say, oh, well, they were hard-headed, stiff-necked. Well, yes, they were. But you know what? So are we.
That's
so are we. That's why we need a Savior. Do you understand what I'm saying? The same thing that happened here, you've got to understand, is the same thing that's happening here. But the difference is when the Messiah hung on that cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Do you see what I'm saying? And he says, now I have the key to death, hell, and the grave. Do you see what I'm saying? And he ushered in. He was the only one qualified. Now I'm going to say that again. He was the only one qualified to be crucified. You see what I'm saying? And lay in Joseph's new tomb. New tomb. You see what I'm saying? New. Okay? Laying there during the Shabbos. Excuse me. The Sabbath. Shabbos is Hebrew. Sometimes I get my languages mixed up. Okay? Because I did study Hebrew. Okay? But on the Sabbath, he laid there and he didn't move a muscle. That's what he was fulfilling, was the Sabbath that they had to do here. Do you see what I'm saying? But then on that third day, how many steps do we have? Well, we have seven steps of the tabernacle, but how many is shown? 1, 2, and 3. Am I correct? So on that third day, here he comes out of that grave. You see what I'm saying? He came out of that grave. What? Changed. A quickening spirit. You see what I'm saying? He was changed so much that he walked amongst the prophets that knew. And he talked to them. And he had to remind them what had happened. You see what I'm saying? You see why it's important to read the scriptures? Even if you don't understand. If you read the scriptures, when a person talks about it, at least you know what they're talking about. You know what I'm saying? And then you wait. And you let Yahweh give you the understanding. Because I can't do it, but I can show you what he taught me. You see what I'm saying? So then here it is. He comes out of that grave. Now look, the men that were put there to protect that grave, when he came out, what happened to them? Look, these are pictorial illustrations. You can find it in the scripture. You see what I'm saying? They're down. And here he comes out. And when he rose, the sons that slept rose with him. But first, he appeared unto his disciples. Okay? And he's walking with them. And he's having to remind them about this and that and the other. And then when he reminded them, it finally dawned on them, oh, this is the one that was crucified. But you know what? He disappeared right out of their sight. Why? Because he didn't want them to think he was physical. You see what I'm saying? Yahweh is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And that's the same thing. There's a transcript that's written in, I don't know if it's 69, 73, 79, where Dr. Kenny's talking about immortality. You know, people talking about immortality. You're going to have it in the flesh. No, you're not going to have it in the flesh. You're going to have it in the spirit. And they said, what do you mean? What do you mean? Well, where does Yahweh live? In the spirit. You see what I'm saying? So, you can have it in the spirit. When I pass, my exterior lays in the grave or gets cremated. But my spirit is what? Is free. That's the immortality. But people are taking it physical. You see what I'm saying? Let me get back to where I was. Okay, yes, there's a difference. Humans have four types of blood. Horses have 13 types of blood. Insects have copper in their blood instead of iron. In other words, we have iron in our blood. Plus, they have blue and green blood. We have blue blood, but when it comes out and oxidizes, it's red. Okay? Apes have blood of a different consistency. They don't know what that consistency is. But they know it's not human. So we didn't come from apes. Okay? Chimps are the closest. They have 90% of blood that we have. Okay? But then there is warm and cold blood. Do you see what I'm saying? So in other words, if you do any research, that's what we are about. We are a research school. So if you take the time to take what was given to you, you will see that no, we are religion because we're not a church. That's the idea people have on religion. I'm not attacking that we research religion. I'm not attacking that. I'm not attacking anything. I'm trying to point out the truth. You see what I'm saying? People ask me, oh, you going to class? Church? No. I'm going to school. I'm going to Bible school. See, that's the difference. But those that are ashamed of this gospel will sit up and say, yes, you going to church? Yes, I'm going to church. Why? You have crucified, you have denied Yahweh in you by saying that. Do you see what I'm saying? No, you are going to school. You are going to Bible school. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, if they want to know, then they ask questions. But 9 times out of 10, you ain't going to find anybody to want to know. So that's how you know that the ones that are here by divine invitation. They won't be here. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now, could you give me that scripture, please?
Was it 14?
Yes, please.
You want 12 or 14?
Well, go ahead and read a little bit 12. Just to get the thing.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground which this weakened the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of El. I will set up also upon the mountain of congregation in the sides of the north.
Okay, now the reason I had this explained is because I'm trying to show, like I said, the ever-presence of Yahweh. You see what I'm saying? That means he has everything controlled. Everything. Nothing escapes the control of Yahweh. So now he says, how art thou fallen? Now you read over there, I think it's either in Revelation or something, when he talks about Lucifer was driven, was cast out. What is that?
12th chapter.
Thank you. Cast out. Could someone get that one for me, please?
Yeah. And there was war in heaven.
Where are you?
12 and 8.
Thank you.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels, and prevailed not.
Now, how will we know that? We weren't there as far as this physical body. We were not there. But you know how you can fix that? Let me show you how you can fix that. There are things, Iggy, that I know you thought. There are things that I know you thought before you came into this gospel. Am I correct? There are things now that you think, that you know, don't go according to what you thought before. So how art thou fallen? You see what I'm saying? Read.
Are we back in Revelation?
Yes.
What?
Which one? How art thou fallen?
You want back in Isaiah, right?
How art thou fallen?
Okay.
Yeah.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? son of the morning.
Now, where is heaven? Where is heaven? Right up here. You see what I'm saying? State of mind. What you think. Now, the church talk about repent. Repent. Born again. Born again Christians. This, that, and the other. Okay? But if you look at the word, just like Will brought up about, oh, there was a word that was used, and it meant one thing, but it meant another one, if you did your research. But repent means rethink. So when you came into this gospel, you rethought what you thought. You see what I'm saying? So then, that's how Yahweh is on your throne and Lucifer is off. You can't have both of them on your throne at the same time. You see what I'm saying? Okay, continue reading that, please.
How art thou cut down to the ground which this weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of El. I will sit upon the mountain of congregation in the sides of the north.
Okay, so now he said, I will ascend. Now the things that you thought before, you thought you're right. Isn't that an ascension? Isn't that an elevation? Thinking you're right? I got the truth. Do you see what I'm saying? So see, there are always physical manifestations to prove what happens in the spirit. Yahweh's ever present. Now go ahead and get that chapter that you was reading before. When he says, I will be above the cloud.
I'm coming up.
Okay.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Okay. Now he says, I will ascend above the lights of the cloud. Okay. Now, look. We have, let's talk about Satan, okay, or Lucifer. Now we have this tabernacle pattern that was raised up in this holy place. Now, where did the Messiah, where did Yahweh say he would dwell? Between the wings of the cherubim. You see what I'm saying? What is Lucifer saying he's going to do? He's going to ascend above. Do you see the difference? Yahweh said, I'm going to be in the cloud, in between the wings of the cherubim. Okay? Lucifer says, I'm going to ascend above. Now, I got this out of a transcript to prove to you that it's written. Dr. Kinley, in 1970. And you know what? It still works today. This gospel does not go out of
style.
Our shoes do, our clothes do, you know. One thing about men, they don't like us women, huh? I'm just teasing. But anyway, give me Leviticus 16 and 2.
16 and 2. And Yahweh said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil, there before the mercy seat which is upon the ark, and he die not, for I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat.
Okay, thank you. So see, this is what all I'm trying to show you, is that any time you have something that feels is going to be better, or going to ascend, or as I say, go ahead of the cloud, and all of these type of things, then you know what type of gospel that is. Mm-hmm. See, we have all of our proof. We don't need no more.
Right.
Use what was given, and it will take you everywhere. Why? Because nothing escapes. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now here you have this tabernacle pattern. All right. Now when you come to this incense, they had was given a specific menu. I'm just trying to make a recipe of how to make this. Okay? But the two sons, what was their name? Decided to add or take away. I can't remember right now.
They didn't have the body.
Thank you. And because of that, they were killed. They were killed and had to be dragged out of this tabernacle. Now, they were Aaron's sons. Now, you and I as natural people, how would we feel if that happened? But when you know that it is Yahweh, the ever-presence of Yahweh, and that he has everything under his control, you see what I'm saying? You don't mourn their loss, sure, but you have to recognize they were disobedient. Otherwise, that would not have happened. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, when you look over here at this carnal ordinances, okay, you have all of the circumcision ceremonies, all of these things here. Now, it was nailed to his cross. Now, the point I want to get to, now we have Adam, he was the first death. But now when he was created outside of the garden. And he was placed in the garden. Now this, the fruition or the trees was in fruition. They didn't need nothing. It was prepared. Yeah. Now that's the same way. When we are born, even though we are born, we think, in the mother's womb, you see what I'm saying? And we come down out of the flesh, we was conceived first here. Do you see what I'm saying? Just like Adam was put in the garden. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now, here he is up here. Now the pictorial illustration that was given, that is given, is that he is cool, calm, and collected. Sitting right there. And he knew his wife, you see what I'm saying? Or the woman that was given to him was being deceived. Do you understand what I'm saying? But now look, let's be real about this. Everybody tries to talk about this, that, and the other. But we're going to talk about the ever-presence of Yahweh. He knew what was going on because he had a purpose right from the beginning. You see what I'm saying? And when, how could I say that? Because Eve was in Adam when the law was given to not touch. You see what I'm saying? But to show he had it covered, in the day that you touch, you shall surely die. But now look, that was a covenant that was made between Adam and Yahweh. Why would I say that? Oh my goodness. Why would I say that? Because she touched and she ate, but nothing happened. It wasn't until Adam partook. You see what I'm saying? That's when the change happened. Showing that the man is responsible. That's why when the Messiah came in, he was responsible. He was the only one. How come Noah? How come when this happened with Noah, this happened with Moses? You would think Moses would have saved him. You see what I'm saying? But these were not the ones that was predestinated to do it. It was Yahshua, the Messiah, who is who? Yahweh, Elohim, manifested in the flesh. Now you have prophets that have the Holy Spirit, but they didn't save you. You see what I'm saying? When they died, what happened? Did they save you? No, they didn't save you. It was Yahshua the Messiah who came in and died the death of an outcast dog. And he said, when he passed, he said what? Father, forgive them for what? They know not what they do. You see what I'm saying? Now, how does he know that? Because it was purpose for him to know that. Because he is Yahweh Elohim, manifested in the flesh. Even the angels desire to understand. Now, how were they to being taught. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that's all I want to share. Do some homework. Read these scriptures. You know, I was going to hit on down here. You know, I wanted to show all of this dragging on and this carnal ordinance is being restored and the Gentiles being grafted in after 7 years. But my time is up. Okay, so I'm not able to do that. But see, that's why we have class. That's why you take it home, because this is an ongoing thing.
That's right.
You cannot learn it. And we've been taught. Someone says, well, tell me about Yahweh. Well, I'm sorry, we can't teach you in 2 hours. We cannot teach you in 2 hours. And what you don't understand, don't condemn yourself. Yahweh has that covered. Because he said, I'm the one that gives the revelation. Thank you.
See if I can get off my dreads.
Thank you.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Wobo.
Still good morning, by the way. Good morning, class. I really appreciate the first speaker's testimony / lecture. I thought it was really good. I'm back home, as some of you can see. I was in Chicago last week. They had a seminar there, Northside Chicago class. And there was quite a few branches that were there. I think at least about 25 different branches that were there. We came about the furthest, I think. But there were people there from Albuquerque, from New York, and Texas, and Florida, and Virginia, and so forth, so on. The theme that they had there was, is there life after death? And so they, and I know the guy personally, who the dean who put together the seminar, and he explained to me his idea for it. He said that he wanted more like a compact, intense experience, because the way he set it up, there was like one class on Friday night, there were three sessions on Saturday, and one session on Sunday morning. But he stretched out the time so that everybody, he got like three or four speakers up, and they had like maybe 30, 40 minutes, you know, to try to hit on the subject, and everybody did pretty good, I thought. I thought everybody did well. Everybody looked at it from different aspects of the pattern, of the purpose, of the plan. Other folks took it from a physical point of view. One guy, well, I thought was very novel. He used the method of what they call the heart thing, the CPR.
CPR.
Yeah, and he used that to show. They said, well, that's a physical example of life after death. Because literally, they tell you that when you're going through a seizure or something like that, you're literally dead. And so they do that, you know, and put the air in, they literally bring you back. So that's literally life after death, okay, just from a physical point of view. So, I mean, it was that kind of thing, and yes, I did. I got a chance to speak there, so. Would have been better if Joe had been there, but I'll talk to him about that when he gets back. But yeah, I did. I got a chance to say a few words. And actually, it wasn't too much far different than some of the stuff the first speaker was saying, because I basically brought up some, you know what I did? I'll just tell you basically what I did. I took a page from Dr. Kennedy's book, literally. Somebody give me the first line, and I'll show you what page I'm talking about. Yeah, I did. I most certainly did. I figured, why not? I mean, if anybody knew the subject better than anybody, it would be Dr. Kinley. And he did write about it, right? He wrote a section, and this is the page I took. Page 91, it says right there, life after death revealed by the pattern. Okay? And see, and unfortunately, when at the place, they had all these charts up and extra, and they had a 40-plate chart up. A full-blown 40-plate, yes, they did. And I hit it right toward there. And so what I did, basically, because Dr. Kinney, he picked 7 specific plates, all right, off the chart, and he lines them up to illustrate his point of life after death. Okay, and that's basically what I did. Now, of course, I couldn't go exhaustively into the 7 steps of each plate because I only had like about maybe 30, 35 minutes. So basically, I just hit some of the high points of it. And but the point was, and I emphasized it, and I even told them about our little slash game exercise that we do here. And people were like, oh, hey, that's novel, you know, and all that kind of. And so, and I think, what echoing the first speaker, somewhat, in a way. I think that over the years, people in the school have truly forgotten how, you know, to use these charts. And because of that, that's why you hear all this spurious stuff over the last 20 years. Okay? But I think that Dr. Kinley explains it. Look, he says it real perfect. I heard it on audio. He says, look, I drew 7 charts and wrote 2 books. And look, and it's enough to save you. If you understand what I wrote and drew. See, now people can say, you know, look, you know, there's other charts, because people are drawing other charts, and you can, and look, you can go through the scriptures and see examples of death, burial, resurrection, or the 7 steps of the pattern to a particular incident where there is no illustration on. All this is just your basic primer to get you started. What you see in this textbook is basically an explanation of these charts that he drew and how to use them. See, and everything in here is basic knowledge, basic understanding. Now somebody said, well, wait, there's some hard stuff in here, like it talks about 2520 and the 490 cycles, and they got a section on the medical section, and they got the old ages and dispensations, and that's, no, it's not. That is basic stuff. That's just your primer. That's your beginning. Mm-hmm. See, and Dr. Kinley said it like this. These are the little things you have to know for you before you can even progress to the bigger things. If you don't understand the little, these are the little things. What you see on these charts, these are the little things. Mm-hmm. If you can't handle the little things, how are you going to handle the big things when you get out here in the 5th, 6th, and 7th ages? Mm-hmm. You can't even handle the little things. This, and look, these are just examples. This ain't no reality. This is just examples for you to look at. But if you can't handle the little things, how about, why would Yahweh give you something big in the 5th age, 6th age, somehow, well, I'm going to give you this. You can't even handle the little things. And that's all Dr. Kinley tried to do. That's why he set up a school. This is a school of instruction. It is a school set up to create able-bodied ministers. For what? To be a conduit. Because really, this vision does not need you to explain itself.
Right.
All it needs is a mouthpiece. A jackass will do. Okay? That's all you're doing up here. I don't know no more about this than you do. I'm just a prop. You know, something Yahweh to use to point at. Mm-hmm. See, I can get down and somebody else get up here and do the same thing, and it's still Yahweh using a prop. Right. You understand my point? But this is something that we all can do. It's not because, oh, I can't do this, it's hard, or you gotta give us. Oh, gosh. But the scripture says, is there anything too hard for Yahweh? I mean, really? See, and that's what Dr. Kinley tried to impart upon us. I mean, he could have made it easy on himself and just created a booth and just had people walk by and he put his hand on them and say, receive ye the Holy Spirit. Next. Receive ye the Holy Spirit. Next. Move along now. Let's play more after you go. Receive ye the Holy Spirit. Next. But he didn't do that. He set up a school of instruction because he knew that we weren't gonna get it the way he got. I mean, he got knocked for a loop. And he used, and look, we don't even do it justice sometimes. We say, This vision and revelation. Wait a minute. Dr. Kimmy used adjectives. He said words like stupendous and colossal. Stupefying. You know, just to try to convey to you the enormity of what he saw. See, and that's the thing. That's all he tried to do. And everything he did, and look, whether it was prophecy, when he made prophecies, he didn't just pull it out the air, out of his hat. He went up to the board and showed you how it was done. And shows you the relationship to it. Here's another example right here. I think I showed it to you a couple weeks. I'll show it again up here. See, here's another chart up here. See, you see it up here, the pattern. And you see the dates of the calendar here. See, why? Let's get this. Genesis 32. I want Jacob's ladder. 32nd chapter. See, because he's showing you this pattern and the principles that are inherent in the pattern. See? Somewhere where Jacob's falling asleep. Where is it at? 8, 9, 10, somewhere. Is that the right chapter? I want where Jacob's ladder. That's what I want. Where he lay down, he dreamed the ladder. That is 29, maybe? Help me out, because I'm getting old, y'all. Y'all should be, younger folks should be on top of this a lot better than me. I know we've gone. Jacob 32. No, it's 20. No, it's 26, isn't it? That's what I'm thinking of. Okay. 28. That's what it is. That's my error. Genesis 28 and 10.
28 and 10. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night. Because the sun was set, and he took of the stones of the place and put them for his pillows and laid down in a place to sleep.
Okay, now let's just stop for a minute. Now let's look at it by the pattern. Now we told you, look, Dr. Kinley lays it out. He lays it out in your textbook. And see, he lays it out here, and I'm going to show you this. On page... 126. He lays it out here. See, he explains it. See, he explains the pattern. He explains the seven steps of the tabernacle pattern as compared to the seven steps of the migratory trek. If you know these seven correlations between these two places, then you know them all. You know these charts. Because everything you're going to look at on these charts, you're going to use these correlations on them. No matter what plate it is, no matter what chart it is, this is correlation number one. I like to call it. This is your prime directive. Let's get Star Trek-y here. That's what it is. If you understand, this is your temple. That's why he devoted a section on this. The number seven denotes perfection, and he goes through and explains each step. And then to add to that, when you turn the next page. He goes into the number seven, why the number seven is so important. And he goes through it to show you that. Now, once you understand that, the correlation between the tabernacle pattern and the migratory trek, you know all these charts.
Yeah.
It's just that simple. It really is. And that's what you have to understand. This is your primer. This is your template. That's the word I'm looking for. See, and we're reading something from Jacob's ladder, see, because he, read where you were at.
12. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set upon the earth.
Now, go back to the scripture.
Okay, 11. And he lighted upon a certain place, and tarried there all night,
uh-huh.
because the sun was set.
Uh-huh.
And he took upon the stones of the place,
uh-huh.
and put them for his pillows, and laid down in the place to sleep.
Now he laid down in the place to sleep. What are you talking about? See, just look at the pattern. Here he is, right here. That's the altar of sin and sacrifice. See, that's a death. Sleep is a death. See, when you go to sleep, that's a death-like state. That's here on the altar, because that's where death happened at.